All right, hello everybody. This is Cornell University Experience is the name of the website that I'm gonna do a little case study here. So I am Aaron. I'm a Drupal developer with about 10 years experience, maintainer for the Drupal Salesforce module. Has anybody used that module? Good. You're better off that way. Message Agency is my company. We are a Philadelphia B Corporation, which means we have completed an extensive company profile and evaluation and met a certain threshold for triple bottom line, which means we have values as a company other than profits. We serve nonprofits, universities, foundations, governments, and mission-aligned for-profit companies. We're a social enterprise, like I said, Philadelphia. So, what's up? So just a couple, I gave this talk at DrupalCon and a couple other times with some folks from Cornell who are not here. Want to shout those folks out. Nick Tubbs is a Drupal developer with Cornell IT. And Arena is a Drupal developer with Cornell as well. So there's about, the presentation is divided into thirds, and I'm going to do my best to represent Nick and Arena's portions of those, but you have to forgive me if I'm a little bit less knowledgeable on those sections. I'll do my best here. So this is the outline of the session, just at intros. We'll give you some background about the project, talk about the challenges we were trying to address, talk about the approach we took to implement those solutions, and then the three separate components here are building the Drupal site, building custom integrations with that site, and the Salesforce integrations with that site. So, background. Cornell University this project originated from the study abroad programs. They have thousands of applicants, thousands of participants, data that they've been tracking for years and years. They have lots of stakeholders, they have lots of user roles, advisors and administrators who they're accepting applicants from not just Cornell, from all other partner institutions, and not just students, grad students, researchers. So huge, huge audience here, very big sort of breadth of this program. And before this sort of project came about, they were doing things in a very sort of old-fashioned way. They were stuck in the sort of early 2000s. So again, audiences, the advisors and staff who need to support, advise, mentor students, various people through this program, various programs, students and other applicants who want to discover these opportunities and browse options, apply to different opportunities, as well as the university sort of leaders, the top brass, so to speak, who see this as one of the core brands to promote Cornell, as an institution. So the existing system, there'll be some screenshots in a minute, but the campus essentially grew out of the existing system. It was messy, it was legacy, it was cumbersome and expensive to maintain, it was hard to make changes, the presentation layer was very, like I said, it looks like a sort of Microsoft product from the early 2000s. And the idea with this project, the experience project, is to centralize the data and create a sort of clearinghouse for all of these opportunities. So, you know, to create a portal for students, a one-stop shop for program administrators, and to sort of streamline the way that, or a one-stop shop for the advisors, and streamline the way that administrators work with the advisors to sort of put these programs together. So again, large project. The legacy system was about 10 years old, and it was very customized for study abroad programs only. So, you know, while they could host something like a research opportunity or a fellowship or an internship, you know, it was really, everything was tailored around study abroad, and you know, the departments, all the offerings sort of had grown beyond just being about study abroad. I have this fancy animations here. So this is the old site, and you can see that, you know, it's functional, sort of, not exactly compelling. And you know, one of the principles of the Cornell sort of brand is that experiencing the Cornell brand should be beautiful, should be a you know, pleasurable experience in addition to being functional. This did not provide them that, and there was no way for Cornell to sort of use this platform to make it look good. So our approach, and our here meaning me and Cornell and message agency came in a little bit later in the process, but Cornell's approach, you know, was to sort of revamp this whole program from a high level, and then sort of select those technologies that, you know, leverage their strengths. So use the tools for the jobs that they were designed for, and that's kind of the theme. One of the themes of this presentation. So you know, they in addition to sort of the journey mapping, user stories, personas. They wanted to look at data, where would it come from, how would we get it, how would it be shared, and have a big focus on the application process, the actual forms of applying for a program or an opportunity, you know, how to make that simple, how to make that intuitive, and as like I said before, presentation is a top priority as well, making the presentation layer not only beautiful, but also customizable, so that it could be maintained and extended.
Just a quick question.
Go ahead.
The previous application, was that like a back-end application or what?
This is the user-facing, this is the website. This is it, yeah. This is where people would come to apply to a study
program. Is it still existing, or now you are in the newer system?
No, it's been replaced. Oh. I'm not 100% on where, you know, all the data came from that was driving this. Whether I'm assuming some of the same systems they're still using to sort of drive that data, but it's all presented through Drupal now. And I'll have screenshots on that in a minute. The big reveal. Here are the priorities. We're kind of jumping ahead here, but when Message Agency became involved, it was at the point where Cornell had identified Salesforce as a technology, as a platform that they wanted to adopt, well, that they had adopted for many of their other sort of programs and departments that they wanted to sort of fold in the study abroad and the sort of these extended learning programs. Basically, university-wide, they've adopted Salesforce, and Drupal was identified by the IT department. Uses, you know, is very experienced in Drupal, and you know, the marketing arm was happy with that decision as far as extensibility, you know, internal support, and one of Cornell's objectives, one of the IT department's objectives, was to identify vendors, message agency, who had experience with Drupal and Salesforce. So, you know, there are a lot of Drupal vendors, there are a lot of Salesforce vendors, but there aren't a ton of us sort of sitting at the intersection of those with a lot of experience. So you know, as the maintainer of the Salesforce module, you know, my name popped up when they did a Google. So that's how we got involved. And you know, I'll talk about our sort of role a little bit later, but so having identified Drupal, sort of done the hi-fi mock-ups and mapped everything out, we're diving into building the Drupal site. So what are the pros, the sort of strong points of Drupal? I don't have to preach to the choir too much here. We know that Drupal is a great content management system. Drupal 8, of course, has powerful presentation layer, extensible APIs, and components to build very powerful systems. Cons, it is DrupalCamp here, so I won't get too much into the cons, but it doesn't do CRM, and you know, I know there are CRM modules, there are integrations with Civi CRM, Red Hat, thank you. There are CRM modules for Drupal. So, okay, it does CRM, but it's not Salesforce. Salesforce is, you know, the CRM. It's got huge market share, it's got huge reach, it's got great support, it's you know, eliminates liability issues of storing all that data. So for all intents and purposes, Drupal doesn't hold a candle to Salesforce in terms of CRM. And another con I think that is maybe underappreciated is that Drupal is very unopinionated. There are almost too many ways to do any given thing. And when you're talking about sort of a very distributed system at a very large enterprise agency like Cornell, you can get around that. You can, you know, sort of lock things down and provide people with, you know, one or two paths to accomplish something. But that's a lot of work in and of itself. Anyway,
there should be in the pros.
I mean, right? It's a mixed blessing for a developer like me. You know, I can do the thing the way I want to do it. We can build our internal technology stack, our Drupal profile and modules, however we want to do it to fit our needs, and that's great. For, you know, like I said, a distributed system, they have an IT department, they have limited staff, but they want, you know, large buy-in from not like untrained, essentially, faculty, staff, advisors who are going to be using this system. So, you know, if we're to try to build a CRM in that environment, like, we have to be very careful about what we allow those people, those users to do in that environment. And I think Salesforce, in the ways that it's opinionated on those with regard to those sort of issues, makes sense in the CRM context a little more than Drupal really could without, you know, reinventing Salesforce. The ways that in which we are building with existing Drupal APIs. So we're sort of jumping around to a few different topics, but all the data that is captured in Drupal, all the public data that's captured in Drupal is exposed via JSON API, so that Drupal's data, Cornell's opportunities, can be consumed and, you know, reposted basically anywhere else. So either within the university, outside of the university. Like I said, the experience.cornell site is a clearinghouse for these opportunities, which, you know, drives more traffic to their programs and lets different departments do what they want to do. So one example is the Global Learning Initiative, and this is like I had nothing to do with this, right? Like, I think Global Learning contacted Nick and Arena, and maybe they sort of handheld them through setting up a site that's essentially decoupled on top of the Drupal experience site. So this is running on the Drupal experience data via the JSON API, its own sort of portal here, tailored around just the global programs. So, you know, among the opportunities listed on the experience site, the JSON API not only exposes data, but gives you tools for filtering, for searching that data. In this case, they've searched for, I mean, I don't know specifically, but my guess is, you know, each of these discover, global, you know, college administered are each a taxonomy term that the Cornell Global Programs has used to build their own site here. Authentication is another one of the sort of APIs that we had to deal with here, and the not so simple SAML PHP library. So single sign-on is very important for Cornell for this experience, and the challenge is the Cornell users, the Cornellians, as they like to refer to themselves, have a NetID, they have, you know, shared authentication throughout Cornell services via LDAP. And Cornell has an identity provider for that, the IDP. But we also want to accommodate the non-Cornellians. And how do we do that in a way that's seamless for everybody? We experimented with a few things. We played with the idea of, you know, trying to guess at, based on the credentials provided, which IDP we should use, and that didn't really work. And where we sort of ended up is the user just has to pick, you know, do I log in with my Cornell NetID or not? Do I log in with other credentials? And the other credentials for the case of the experience site is Salesforce. So the non-Cornelians get a community Salesforce license. They register with Salesforce instead of Drupal, and then Salesforce is their IDP when they come and log in. And Simple SAML does the just-in-time creation of the Drupal user on the Drupal side. So we're not like, you know, pulling every single user from Cornell's LDAP. We're not pulling every single contact from Salesforce and pre-creating all those users in Drupal. That happens, like I said, just in time. When they're authenticating. So, you know, I'm not going to go into detail about configuring SAML because I didn't do it, and for two it's would take too long. But it's possible to register two different IDPs in the SAML library. There's a number of files that need to be sort of configured, and there's instructions on how to do that in the Simple SAML PHP documentation. And then the Simple SAML PHP auth module is the Drupal module that hooks up the Simple SAML PHP library to Drupal. And I'm not sure if that patch is on drupal.org or where exactly this patch comes from. I apologize for that. But there is a user interface for configuring Simple SAML, and then, you know, if your IDPs have different authentication keys, you enter those into the configuration and comma separate them to use them for the different systems. And I'm doing a lot of hand waving here because I'm not super confident in how SAML works, so please don't ask me anything. So discovery service is kind of a fancy way to say, like, the user, you know, has to pick how they want to log in. So these are sort of iterations on how that evolved. And we end up with something that looks sort of like this. So it looks, you know, it looks like a Cornell. It's Cornell branded. It looks similar on the Drupal site and on the Salesforce site. And if they're on Drupal, they click, you know, log in with Salesforce, they bounce over to Salesforce to log in and come back to Drupal. If they're on the Salesforce site, they can bounce over to directly to the IDP, to the Cornell IDP if they want to log in with LDAP. So those are sort of the contrib and, you know, Drupal native APIs. Of course, a number of others that we used. The custom integrations are sort of vary in size, but using some Drupal APIs, creating some other APIs, whole cloth. There were a number of items that we need to build custom, and by we, I don't mean me, I mean Irina, for the most part. So TerraDotta is a data repository for various things, but Cornell has a lot of their study abroad opportunities there, so they needed to, and they are still using TerraDotta, so they needed to synchronize that somehow into the new Drupal site. So they're using a data load so that Drupal can consume the TerraDotta XML and turn that into native Drupal content. And from there, it goes all the way to Salesforce. So you sort of have this, it's not exactly a replica, but it's kind of this synchronization pipeline. Class roster, again, is another data warehouse whose data Drupal is consuming to turn that into native content again and push some of that, up to Salesforce. And then you have a good amount of data that program advisors are entering manually into Drupal. So, curating their own programs, just logging into Drupal, entering their content right there. Irina wrote most of this, so I don't know all the complexities and why the custom data load made more sense than, for example, using feeds. But I know that it's somewhat automated. It runs periodically based on cron, consumes that data, and like I said, turns it into Drupal content. This is another relatively simple example using a view field plugin. So essentially, the little snippet here, what you see is this will make more context when you see the whole site. I hope that slide is coming up soon. But at the bottom of each opportunity, based on the context of that opportunity, whether it's accepting applications, whether it's open to the particular user role who's logged in, they'll get a contextual link using a view plugin based on their based on their user context. So that's a views API. We're using Google Search API, to create this custom search interface on the UI. Not a whole lot to say about that. So reverse geocoding. So this tool allows program advisors to essentially click on a map in the node form, reverse geocodes to find the closest city, and then pushes the latitude and longitude as well as their guess for the city up to Salesforce. And then in Salesforce the data is very normalized in Salesforce, so each city, each country, each continent or region has its own table in Salesforce, so that when this information gets posted up there, we're sort of joining to those existing records instead of creating a new entry for every single lat-long pair. So that's using the Google Maps geocoding API. This one's cool. So this is like an autocomplete widget that looks up a user reference via LDAP based on the their login ID, and then basically does that just-in-time user creation to reference that user if they don't exist yet. Good. Yeah, here's the site, and I'm gonna do a demo of this one actually. Let me turn to that demo. So here's the site. This is the homepage, and you can see very different from the old sort of Excel spreadsheet looking version of the site. And the idea here is kind of like a Netflix experience to search and discover various opportunities. Like I said, research opportunities, internships, job placements, study abroad, fellowships. And when we sort of get down into the listings here, based on these different categories, you can search, you can filter, and I'm not gonna submit this because we know how that goes, live demos. But what I can show you is this pretty cool feature where we can compare opportunities, and this is all run via views and a relatively thin layer of JavaScript that basically attaches to these checkbox clicks and submits an AJAX request to render this is a view down here, and then these are bulk operations, or it's a I don't know if they're still called that in Drupal 8, but then we can actually compare those. That takes us to another view that takes those arguments and then renders your sort of standard sort of comparison here. So this is I helped Irina put this together a little bit. I think that's one of the cooler features.
So is each opportunity, do you have like an opportunity content type or something?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
And that's where all of that is captured.
The opportunity content type is here. So a lot of this, so everything in the sort of in the middle content well here is native Drupal content. Well, it's all native Drupal content. Everything in the content well is WYSIWYG content that lives solely in Drupal. And then just about everything else, this apply button, all the sort of metadata on the left and the right is driven from Salesforce.
The requirements too?
The requirements as well. And that's the requirements are another whole, like this whole normalized thing in Salesforce. Where they can select eligibility years, different schools, they have GPA requirements, they can create new kinds of requirements, and then the application process, there's like three different application types, one of which is connected to Salesforce. This example is a third party, so this doesn't go to their Salesforce site. I will demo one that does when I get to that slide a little bit later. But so let me try and get back to the slides here. Right, so rendering it, so that's rendering a view with AJAX. That was fun project. I love JavaScript. Other times we found it useful to render a page. It's kind of like headless, but not really. It's just Java. It's just basically we render a Drupal page and then build the DOM with JavaScript. In this case, it was much easier to do it this way than to try and build like a views adapter or a views data plugin. The data that you see here is actually queried, not in real time, but it's queried real time and then it's cached for a few minutes on the Drupal side. So none of the data in this table lives in Drupal. And while it's possible, again, to build a data adapter for a various data backend with views, it was easier to just sort of run that query, render, spit the JSON out, and then render it with JavaScript. Thanks to some of the idiosyncrasies of the Salesforce API, the overhead in sort of managing that, we decided the trade-off wasn't worth it. What else is on here? So similar, this is a custom block that I think this, I'm not exactly sure what all this is displaying. I think this is programs by, term and year. And again, something that was expedient to do with a database query rather than try and put some views together to build this. So again, just as an example of using Drupal's APIs to do pretty cool stuff with relatively low effort.
Have you ever tested the performance of your page?
I have not. No. But like I said, we are using Drupal cache pretty heavily. So, you know, where there are network calls, like, and I'll get to this in the Salesforce bit a little, somewhat, like, basically the first time the user logs in, there's a black box endpoint where we send the net ID and we get all the information we need for that user's session that gets cached for the duration of their session. And then there's like, you know, there's some cache and validation triggers that cause that to be updated when the information changes. And we can, you know, we sort of push that from the Salesforce side. So the user comes, they submit an app, they, you know, they log in, the page load after they hit login button, like that might be a longish page load compared to the rest of the site.
What is the site hosted? Is it hosted?
This is Pantheon.
Oh, Pantheon.
Yeah.
CDN? CDN?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean.
So that should help.
It helps, yeah. They have a lot of authenticated traffic, so that'll bypass like a good amount of the front-end cache, but the assets and those sort of things get cached pretty well. And where we are using views, you know, those have their own headers. Let me jump into the Salesforce stuff. Any questions so far? Any other questions?
So my only question is, Salesforce manages the opportunities for every user, or what exactly Salesforce does?
Great question. I'm going to get right into that. So,
I'm wondering, you know. So.
Yeah, no. I mean, that's a great question. So, and I have a slide on just that. So the pros of Salesforce. Salesforce is very good at reporting. The report building tools in Salesforce are almost as good as Views, but they're way more intuitive to database administrators, and There are a lot of canned views that are view or not views reports that are bundled with packages or you know standard reports within Salesforce, and like Drupal, it's not just a you know one application. It's a platform, so they have their own programming languages, a database framework. You can do all kinds of really powerful stuff just in Salesforce. And again, you know, Cornell identified Salesforce as the technology that they wanted to go with before sort of deciding to build any particular application with Salesforce. They did identify the cons. You know, it's very expensive in terms of having a full seat on Salesforce, even for someone like Cornell. It's expensive. For nonprofits, they offer 10 free licenses. Which is like you know a good hook for especially for smaller nonprofits and coupled with Drupal can be very powerful to sort of circumvent some of those expenses. And Salesforce doesn't do CMS, you know, with an asterisk. They have a CMS product that they're marketing very heavily and want people to use and don't really appreciate that. We're circumventing their license restrictions by using Drupal. They have not offered any support for the Drupal Salesforce module. But for all intents and purposes, it's not really much of a CMS compared to Drupal. So you know, again, marrying Drupal and Salesforce gives us sort of the best of both worlds here. There are a number of integration points that I'm going to cover, and I will definitely also talk about you know, how the different personas interact with Salesforce or with Drupal and sort of where those lines are. That was something that was very important in sort of outlining all the user journeys as Cornell was designing the site was, you know, they really didn't want people to have to flip back and forth between Drupal and Salesforce and know what to do and where. They wanted it to be sort of intuitive. So, you know, the students are interacting with both systems technically, but it's a very seamless experience. And the the limited sort of set of pages that are user-facing, that are hosted with Salesforce, are you know, they do look different. They don't have the full Chrome of the experience site, but they're branded, and you know, the package that the Salesforce consultant put together is amazingly powerful and very well thought out. So it's a very seamless UX. Okay. So the Salesforce integration, we have, you know, we have user data, opportunities data coming in Drupal site. In the middle here, the experience at Cornell is the Drupal site. The experience site is publishing its data via JSON API, public data, not user personal information. And we have data going in both directions between Drupal and Salesforce, and the reporting is done from Salesforce. So what's happening in the application processing side of things? We're gonna take a look at that. What's happening with the user data? We're gonna take a look at that. And you know, this whole chart, now that I've said all that, is kind of hogwash. There's not exactly a clear separation as the chart would lead you to believe, but those are sort of the high level directions. Really, you know, the Drupal site is pulling information from Salesforce. We're taking some user data and putting that in Salesforce. So it's just kind of a roadmap. So this chart illustrates sort of the integration points, and we're going to talk about the methods that we use to integrate those, which, you know, it's basically we pulled out all the stops. There's a lot going on for this site. So this is just an example of, so this is Salesforce Schema Builder, and I'm going to demo this in real time too because it's a fun tool. I hope I am. So this tool allows you to navigate basically all the tables and objects that you have set up in Salesforce. And it's just it's a cool way to visualize things, and you can drag stuff around, you can turn things on and off, and I bring it up because it's not only a kind of cool tool to play with, but just to show you sort of some of the scope of this project. You can see sort of I've turned on a very small subset of all the tables that they have defined in Salesforce here. And you can see the relationships between those. So there's a lot going on here. The package they have in Salesforce allows their program administrators to create a whole custom application, meaning like, you know, a form that you fill in to apply for a program, all in Salesforce. They can create new requirements. They can create multi-step, multi-page applications, and all that data gets normalized and collected from the student. And they don't have to worry about the presentation layer. It's all done through, you know, this package that they've commissioned. Right, so how are we working with all this data? So one method is with the Salesforce module. The sort of principle of the Salesforce module is we take a Drupal content type or a Drupal entity, Drupal table, however you want to think about it, and map that to a Salesforce table, field by field, which works pretty good for most things.
So you transfer to JSON or the... How do you do the transfer between Salesforce and Drupal?
That's what the module's for. So the module takes care of transforming Drupal data into REST data that we can push up to Salesforce. It takes care of querying and pulling data from Salesforce that we can transform into native Drupal content. For Cornell, we have 9 different Salesforce tables to map to 4 different Drupal types, different events that we're using, and over a dozen patches that came out of this project that made their way back to Drupal.org. And you know, when you're dealing with an integration of any significant complexity, really, any integration with Salesforce that I've dealt with, there's going to be a layer of business logic, of custom code, essentially. And you know, the Salesforce module makes that as easy as possible. There are lots of different events that get triggered where contrib space can sort of inject that business logic. And we also use that layer to deal with the mismatches between sort of Drupal's schema, the Drupal way of doing things, and Salesforce. For example, like Salesforce doesn't have this notion of multi-valued fields. That's kind of a Drupalism. Most database systems have like a join table where the relationship is specified like row by row. You don't have, you know, delta 0, delta 1, that sort of thing. So there are a lot of pitfalls. I have a whole separate presentation about all the pitfalls of implementing integrations with the Salesforce module. And I'm happy to answer questions on that after the presentation. So what does a plan look like for you know, creating one of these integrations? You know, we worked with Cornell for a month or two. They had a very aggressive timeline. We still spent a month or two with them identifying, you know, field by field, content type by content type, you know, where is the source of truth for this data? What are the fields that we're going to have on our content types? You know, are we pushing? Are we pulling? Are we syncing? What's the business logic for each of these data points? You know, groupings, labels, requirements, speccing all that out. And this document in particular was invaluable when we actually got to working, because like I said, there were, you know, this was a small team, but across 3, 4, 5 different people, you need a reference. You need some kind of documentation like this to make this system work. We also have specs for the various mappings and web services. I'll get to those in a second. So this is the Salesforce mapping user interface. So each of these rows is a mapping entity, and this defines, you know, how a Drupal entity relates to a Salesforce entity, you know, field by field there. And so we looked at this a little bit earlier, but like I said, basically everything that's not this middle content well is syncs with Salesforce or pulled from Salesforce. Same thing here, right? The image, and the teaser are not in Salesforce. Everything else has some sort of connection with Salesforce. So that's the Salesforce module. The Apex package. So in addition to the, you know, like I said, the application that this enables, the package includes business logic on the Salesforce side, triggers, custom code, custom classes, and again, what this package enables is for non-Cornelians or Cornell students who are not administrators to use a community license rather than a full, you know, expensive license. And this is several orders of magnitude cheaper. Like 100 or 1,000 community licenses are the same price as one full seat. So this is a big deal to make sure we could do that. So where does the package come in? So from the experience site, I find a program that I want to apply. If it's a Cornell program that has an application, this is the Salesforce site. So at this point, the user has logged, has authenticated either to Salesforce or to LDAP, and they're on Salesforce now. So, you know, it looks different. Like I said, it doesn't have the same Chrome. But this is a native sales, not native. This is a custom form that lives on Salesforce that's built via the Ajax package, via the application that an administrator has built. So everything here you see is customizable. What does that data look like? This screen is a view for the program administrator. So a program administrator essentially never leaves Salesforce. Just like that program advisor, who's, you know, like a, it's, this is like a faculty who's like the chaperone for the, you know, trip to Italy or whatever. That's the advisor. The program administrator is like, you know, the department staff who are making sure that the faculty have entered the program data correctly and actually do the work of building the application according to the spec for the program that they need. So the program administrator basically lives in Salesforce. They can see all the data that they need via custom dashboards, custom reports, and the whole sort of business process is knit together with this with Salesforce and this package. So that's the package, and that sort of integration part is you know, relatively minor, right? We basically just, it's a link, right? We click that link from Drupal and we get to Salesforce. When we finish the application process on Salesforce, we click a link and it sends us back to Drupal. And then it's the data collection that's the important part of that. Then we're using things like the web services and the Salesforce module to actually pull that data back and forth. So, you know, given some of the complexities I talked about earlier with the schema mismatches, you know, we found the need to sort of, like I said, black box some of that business logic. So rather than create, you know, 10 more mappings to pull down data from all those different tables in Salesforce, we expose a custom Apex web service endpoint, and Apex is a Salesforce programming language that lets us expose that data via an API. So, you know, using the Salesforce module, there's a Salesforce REST client inside that Drupal module, and we can build a consumer for our custom web services very easily with, you know, a few lines of code. And like I was saying, you know, when the user logs in, we send the identifier to Salesforce. Salesforce sends us back, you know, structured data from various tables. We don't care how they got the data, but we have a spec. We know what that data is going to look like, and we know what to do with it. And we don't have to worry about, you know, if that business logic changes on the Salesforce side. It's all encapsulated there. We're not recreating it. Right, so this allowed us to sort of, again, distribute some of that workload. Their Salesforce admin built a web service for us based on the spec to sort of to keep that all in Salesforce. So again, what does that look like on the student side? They have a application dashboard that's powered from the data that we get back from web service. So you can see, you know, there's a lot of fussy stuff going on, like the checklist steps, the actions to confirm or withdraw their application. You know, if they haven't completed an application yet, they can see that, they can follow up with that, they can, you know, resume partway through. So, you know, again, while it would be possible for this to live natively in Drupal, it would be a lot of fussy stuff to build this with, for example, with Drupal views. This is the program advisor view. So, you know, as an advisor, I can come in and see all the programs that are in my charge. I can see how many people have applied to those, when the deadline is, if I need to sort of poke anybody to remind them to apply, or if I have applications to review. And this is sort of the zoom in. I've clicked down to see the applicants to any of my various programs. And again, this is driven from that black box custom Apex endpoint. And the last thing I mentioned, just because it's technically a Salesforce integration point, is SAML. I don't have a ton to say about this. Setting up Salesforce as an IDP, there's a user interface for it. There's no programming involved. You upload a certificate and, you know, set up your configuration, and you're basically ready to go. The hard part was on the Drupal side to create that the consumer, the auth consumer, with simple SAML. So again, so key takeaways, you know, using the right tool for the job, and that was something, you know, that message agency has always sort of stressed. You know, we are a Drupal shop, but if it makes more sense for somebody not to build a donation form on their site, you know, they don't have staff to manage that, they don't have budget, we'll send them to a third party service. You know, if it doesn't make sense to reproduce all of the same business logic mistakes, all the same business processes, you know, when we're building a new site, we're not going to try and we want to make a tool. We want to make tools for people. We don't want to, you know, just sign them up and have them indebted to us. And that was something Cornell, you know, in our meetings with them, they sort of brought to us, was, you know, this idea like we need to use the right tools for the job, and that was a very refreshing thing to hear from the client, because we're beating people over the head with that all the time. So they're a great team to work with on that front. You know, and again, I don't have like exposure to most of their stakeholders. I have mostly exposure to their IT team, but from what I've heard, they've got very positive feedback. And this is sort of an ongoing project. They were able to deploy an MVP, and I mean, once they started actually started developing, it was 6 months or so, with their team of two or three in house. And they're still making improvements, enhancements to various pieces, including the Salesforce integration and the other integrations. If Irina and Nick were here, they would talk more about future directions and future opportunities here for Experience Site. And that's about it. We have time for questions. If anybody has more questions.
So my question, why Cornell implemented only for study abroad? Even this can be done for even application processing, general application processing too, right?
Exactly. Yeah, and that was, you know, having come from a system that was so heavily customized for study abroad, they have designed this new system with that concern in mind, where it could be, not exactly white boxed or white labeled, but very extensible, and you know, they can run applications for anything. I mean, they can build anything that needs an application form, they can build it.
We still use the Salesforce.
Running through their Salesforce package, and it can run through. I mean, it doesn't even necessarily have to go through the Drupal Experience site.
I have a question. I don't know if you answered it and I missed it, but you talked about the TerraDotta data.
Yes.
Was that pulled in through Drupal, or was that pulled in through Salesforce, or how was that?
Yes, the TerraDotta. So the TerraDotta data gets pulled in to Drupal. TerraDotta publishes an XML or XML reporting tool of some sort. I'm not totally clear on the specifics, but I know that it's basically their opportunities.
Because the opportunities are in Salesforce, and then they were getting pulled into
the opportunities. Drupal. So some opportunities come. So Drupal sort of orchestrates various data sources.
Oh, all the
so they'll come from TerraDotta. They'll come from class roster. Or they'll be entered in Drupal directly, and then they get pushed up to Salesforce.
Okay.
They can also be entered directly in Salesforce and get pulled down to Drupal.
Could work both ways, okay.
Yeah.
And the TerraDotta was added to the actual experience in Drupal.
TerraDotta comes through Drupal and then to and then up to Salesforce.
Oh, okay.
So there's like a cron job that pulls the TerraDotta XML file and imports anything that doesn't exist yet. And once that happens, you know, the mapping and everything is already set up in Drupal. So if it's ready to get published up to Salesforce, then it does. On the opportunities, like there's a flag, like, I mean, there's some business logic around which fields have to get filled out before it gets pushed up to Salesforce. And then once the advisor pushes it up to Salesforce, the administrator says, you know, okay, I have some work to do on this, or it's not ready to publish. They do their work, and then they set a flag that then comes back to Drupal, and it gets published.
I'm actually working on a project wrong. Very similar right now. Sans the Salesforce part, that's why I asked.
Oh, okay.
So they're bringing TerraDotta data into Drupal.
Okay. Like I said, I didn't actually build any of that.
That's okay. I was just kind of curious about how it worked. It was manual, it was automated, or what.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
I have one more question.
Yep.
So how is the performance? Because you are always pulling from a third party, that means you are going from Salesforce, pulling in the data to the REST API and then publishing it.
Right.
Do you see any performance issue?
So the question is about performance. The way that we get around that is one for that by black boxing most of the data for a request. So when a student logs in, like I said, we pull all the data that they will need for their session. So anything that's going to be customized for their experience, personalized, we get on that first request and we cache it for their session. If they end up filling out an application, filling out one of those Salesforce forms, that round trip will trigger a refresh of that data. So even on those pages where we're rendering, we're rendering content from Salesforce, it's cached on the Drupal side. So it's not native content, but we eliminate that extra network hop by grabbing it when they first log in. And then the Salesforce module does everything asynchronously. All the synchronization that happens via the mappings and the module that we define happens during cron.
Any ethics concern? Because the students' details will be provided to Salesforce. Is there any ethics concerns?
That is above my pay grade.
I was thinking about it.
I mean, this is not like, I don't think, yeah, I mean, it's a good question. I assume I assume Cornell has, ethics review, ombudsman sort of thing. I don't think there's, this is data that they would have been collecting some way. They would have been collecting it via paper or some other system, and obviously for their students, they already have most of this data besides maybe the specific itinerary.
But they're sharing with their third party, right? That's what I'm asking, if there's any of this.
Sure, and I don't know what the agreement looks like with Salesforce. I'm 99% sure that Salesforce is not allowed to resell any of that data.
Let me.
I would be shocked if Salesforce were selling that data.
Yeah.
I mean, especially given how much they're paying for the licenses. Like, if it were free, then okay, maybe. Maybe that's the product.
But licensing also, I was thinking how they charge it, right? So. Your organization, like 10 salespeople, they will buy 10 licenses from Salesforce, right? But in this case, how do they do that?
I mean, the program
do you
administrators.
Do it at the enterprise level?
They have enterprise agreement, yeah. So they'll buy a pack. I don't know how many seats they have specifically, but it's not enough for everyone involved in the university, right? It's not enough for all their students to have.
Yeah.
To have full seats, even that, like I said, even for Cornell, like, it's price prohibitive.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, there is a GDPR, the European
Well, and again, I think, you know, to some extent that's Salesforce's problem.
But I'm sure they are aware of it. They implement the rules and they have to follow them.
Right, right.
Otherwise it will be penalized and that makes so much money.
Absolutely, absolutely.
They have to protect the data.
Nice, thank you.
All right, yep. Thanks everybody.
Thank you.
Enjoy your happy hour.